It's Josh Jaywitz Wittenkeller here with Kyle Pukasukovich. We're back and we're already ready for another round of Pokemon Regionals trading card game action.
We're all the way to the top four. That means just two matches left today, and then we will crown our champion. We're going to feature Kyle once again. Just won that match. Going up against three-time world champion Jason Kozinski. This should be a pretty good matchup.
On the other side of the bracket, we do see William Boatman has completed his game. He's playing that Trevenant deck, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we're actually not sure what's happening between Ross Cawthon and Dane right now. But
too surprising.
Because we do have at least... Ouch, Kyle. We do have one at least determined top four matchup between Kyle and Jason, so we figured why not show it to you guys right now?
Yeah, why not? We have the game ready to go. It is going to be a pretty similar matchup to the last round. Of course, Kyle's still running that Aromatisse deck. He can't switch decks in between games.
But and why would you with this kind of success?
Exactly. There we see Kyle's... his achievements once again. We can add a top four to the list.
He can already, cross off, I did something better in 2015.
And potentially even a finals or a first place finish. But yeah, there's his deck once again, that Aromatisse Seismitoad deck, also featuring
Featuring
10 other
everything,
Pokemon.
Yeah. Every holographic card you've ever seen.
Yeah, and then here's Jason Kozinski's deck. Of course, same deck he ran yesterday, Seismitoad Shaman, and then running those tech cards, those Dragalge and Absol.
Oh, is that a typo? It just says world's first three times there in the accomplishments.
No, he's won that tournament three times.
Oh, man. One of the most consistent players of all time. Still doing great in this regional championship and still playing that Seismitoad deck that we saw him from yesterday. But one key change for him compared to Kyle's last opponent is that he is running one Enhanced Hammer.
That's true. Just going back to Jason's accomplishments, if you actually listed all of his tournament wins, they would take up the whole page. They would not fit in that box.
You could even, some argue that he's won four worlds if you go back to 2002's Tropical Mega Battle. he has been pretty much the face of the competitive trading card game since its inception, and that has not changed over the years.
Yeah, and it sounds like these players are set up and ready to go, so we're going to jump into the top four at the Wisconsin Regional Championship.
All right, and Jason, he's been here before so many times, always so calm and collected. Kyle, he told me the nerves are shooting through him, but he did say prior to winning yesterday, he had a 5-game losing streak on streams. So he's at least very excited to start turning that around. It might even become a 3-game winning streak.
Yeah, he's got a new streak now, 2 wins. So this is going to start off exactly the same as our first match of the day started, with a Seismitoad against Aegislash EX, and there we see Stellar Guidance already going for Pokemon Fan Club.
And one great thing about the expanded format, we've already seen him often Ultra Ball for Jirachi, but he can Level Ball for it now.
Yeah, Level Ball is an incredibly good card. We saw it quite a bit in standard format last year, of course, did rotate out. But yeah, once expanded rolls around, any deck that runs Pokemon with 90 HP or less, definitely going to be playing Level Ball.
So Kyle opts to get a Spritzy so that he can finally start getting an Aromatisse as quickly as possible, as well as a Malamar. And I do believe the Malamar is going to have much more of an impact this game than his last opponent, because Jason Kozinski, I believe, does not run the Keldeo.
That's right. His only way to really get out of those special conditions are Super Scoop Up and AZ. Not great ways to get out of those special conditions. Super Scoop Up is a coin flip, and speaking of coin flip, He does wake up. But Super Scoop Up, a coin flip, AZ forces you to discard the cards attached to that Pokemon when you scoop it up. So, Malamar is going to be huge.
So, Jason, right off the bat, flipping for the hammer. Looks like it fell off camera, but was still Tails.
Yeah. Looks like the energy is going to stay there, so definitely is Tails. We'll see Trainer's Mail after this, so we're probably going to see a long turn here, folks.
Oh, yeah. No, this deck is built for speed, and so he's going to try and use as many Shaman as he can, as many Super Scoop Ups, Resets, Hammers, whatever he can do to start disrupting turn one.
That's right. So we're going to see Ultra Ball on this first turn, discarding two Professor Sycamore. He's going to be drawing so many cards with Shaman EX that... who needs a supporter card?
I can't even believe that the world exists where you can say, I don't really need the Sycamore right now.
Yeah, but that certainly is the case. I wonder what Pokemon Jason's going for here. He could take a second Shaman EX. There's one in his hand already. Could take another Seismitoad EX or even go for that Skrelp.
And it does at least give him an opportunity to search through his deck, determine what's prized.
Right. So if I had to guess, I would say he'll probably just take another Seismitoad EX here. Just play as many cards down as he can and then go for a big setup with Shaman EX.
If I'm not mistaken, I do believe that the Enhanced Hammer is in the deck. I think I caught a glimpse of it. That's going to be the savior card for Jason.
Oh, yeah. That's one thing he's probably checking for. Do I have Enhanced Hammer? Because being able to instantly discard a special energy every time Kyle plays it, I mean, that's just an extremely valuable resource.
And now, we didn't see it last game, but if Kyle can somehow summon that Regirock to his aid, that's going to be one of the first things he wants for just sort of barricading his energy.
Yeah, unlike Aaron in the previous round, Jason is not running that Archaeops, so Aromatisse will be much easier to put into play.
So Jason swapping stadiums for the Verbank City Gym, increasing his poison damage count.
And there we see the first setup of the turn.
Ooh, there it is.
Speaking of Enhanced Hammer, looks like he's got one.
You don't have to flip for that.
That's right. You do have to flip for that, though. Super scoop up. See if he can scoop up that Shaman EX. And it looks like that is head, so we're going to see yet another setup.
Jason, I know you can't hear us, but could you please keep the coin on the table so we can see it too? That would be fun.
There we see an attachment to Seismitoad EX, so Quaking Punch definitely going to happen. And another setup.
Look at that. He has hammers he doesn't even need now.
And I think he's going to be looking for probably a Hypnotoxic Laser off this Trainer's Mail.
And he digs more hammers. Actually, no laser here. Muscle Band, perhaps. Yeah. It doesn't help him against Aegislash, though.
Yeah, I actually wonder what his plan is this turn. I mean, if he could, he might be trying to find... Yeah, he'll take the Muscle Band, and he'll probably try to dig for a Lysander. And if he could Lysander out the Spritzy, knock it out with Quaking Punch before Aromatisse comes into play, that would be a pretty big deal.
Yeah, even though it looked kind of risky to discard those Sycamore early in, Jason knows the importance of some of his other supporter cards, and he figures, if I can keep drawing with Shaman, maybe I can hit one of those.
Yeah, we see a lot of people kind of cut down to one Lysander in their deck because you have all those Versus Seeker. Jason, though, still keeping at two, so he's much more likely to draw it than other decks would be.
So there's the Muscle Band, and set up for three, looking for, you know, perhaps Laser. You got Toad. He did get, I guess, a Team Flare tool that he can throw on his opponent, but yeah, I don't think that's what he wanted.
Could throw a Headringer on Aegislash. I don't think you want to bother putting it on Malamar or Jirachi or maybe Shaman. Yeah, he's going to put the Headringer there, but it's kind of a moot point.
Yeah, it is. No laser this turn, though, and I'm not even... Does he have a draw supporter? He does have Versus Seeker. I suppose he can... get one of those Sycamore back now.
But it's got to be upsetting for him. He probably was looking for Lysander. If Aromatisse comes into play, we've seen how devastating Kyle's deck can be. So if you can cut that off before it comes into play, that's one of the biggest advantages you can get on the Seismitoad side.
Now, Kyle will still be hit by a Quaking Punch by the end of this turn, meaning that he can no longer play his item cards. So the question is, can he get that Aromatisse out through the... not the Aroma Lock, the Item Lock.
Yeah. But yeah, Kyle, again, can play kind of a patient game because, well, Aegislash is Mighty Shield,
first
won't take
card,
any damage.
First card's that laser that Jason so desperately wanted. Otherwise, Aegislash is the perfect wall, cannot be moved. But here, three damage counters between turns with Poison and Verbank City Gym in play.
Yes, there we see Hypnotoxic Laser. At least he found that this turn to start generating some damage. And Quaking Punch will begin. No item cards for Kyle.
All right, so it looks like we see a Quaking Punch. Zero damage, but still having quite an effect, preventing Kyle's item cards.
Yeah, now Kyle has a few turns to get some stuff going, but he's definitely going to want to find those Virizion EX and Darkrai EX eventually. Gets the energy on Malamar for that Hyper Hypnosis. And we mentioned earlier that will be huge for potentially breaking up Quaking Punch. But, yeah, he's going to need to find some of those other important Pokemon eventually.
Well, digging for important Pokemon, we see a big Sycamore for seven, hoping to see Aromatisse, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah, and it looks like he may have missed once again. So no Aromatisse, he'll have to pass the turn, and we'll see if Seismitoad EX wakes up.
Yeah, it's going to be big. It's a game of flips, but Malamar giving you that 50-50 chance of keeping your opponent asleep every single turn you attach an energy. So good. Does not pay off here, though.
Yeah, so far Jason is 2-for-2 on waking up. Of course, it's a 50-50 shot of waking up, so coin flips going his way so far.
So even after that, you know, Jason will usually play a few coin flips of his own, super scoop ups, perhaps even just going straight in with the AZ. But for now, content to play this game. The stadium was not swapped either. I think that's one of the first times we've seen Kyle have to deal with that. So he's going to be getting a continual 3 damage counters.
That's right. So here, Jason, I mean, there's kind of a weird balance when you have Lysander's trump card in your deck to reuse all of your resources. We do see Absol with the Cursed Eyes moving 3 damage counters over to Spritzy. Ooh. This could be big if he can find AZ or Super Scoop Up.
Super Scoop Up. Yeah, 2 Absol. Oh, my goodness. Check this out. Here's a snipe. If he wants to pick up Absol, he can pick it up, pick it down. Put it down. Look, all that damage that Aegislash absorbed goes straight to Spritzy after 2 movements of 3 damage counters at a time. Jason taking a stealth prize, but certainly a valuable one.
Yeah, Absol is one of my favorite cards from Roaring Skies. I feel like this card has a lot of potential to have some crazy plays just like that one. He doesn't mind keeping Aegislash EX active. It's already poisoned, so it'll continually take damage, but he gets to take a knockout for free and continue to keep that poison damage going.
Oh, it's just brutal. And it's even better in decks where you're already running a full set of Super Scoop Up, a couple of AZ. Just those pick up, put back down abilities can really pay off.
Right. And I don't think he's even played a supporter card yet. So we'll have to see if maybe he can find one of those Crushing Hammers or Enhanced. Well, he's already played his Enhanced Hammer. But if he can find a Crushing Hammer, discard that energy off Malamar EX. Yeah. Keep the lock going.
Yeah, discarding Kyle's energy would be the last thing to make this the perfect turn. I mean, already he's done so much to slow Kyle down. That would be sort of the final nail in the coffin.
That's right. So we see an N, a little bit of strange ordering with that. Jason's only going to take 5 cards now off of this N because he did take a prize card with that Cursed Eyes from Absol. But, you know, he kind of had to play Super Scoop Up before playing N, so taking the prize card bites him a little bit.
Speaking of Super Scoop Up, that really seems like one of the last playable cards Jason has outside of this tool. And the question is, do you want to reset a Shaman right now or hold on to that in case your Seismitoad remains asleep? He opts, hey, I don't want this thing remaining asleep. I'd like a chance to get out of it.
Oh, yeah. Using Quaking Punch is way more important than anything else right now. Kyle is able to find his other Pokemon fan club right here, which means he'll be able to search out some of those important Pokemon like Virizion EX.
So we do see Trevenant. The question is, if you have it, do you go for another Spritzy?
I'm not sure. I mean, Trevenant EX, it's not going to be entirely great here. I mean, it can use the first attack for 40 damage. It's usually better once you have a bunch of energy in play. I wonder if Kyle has Virizion EX or if it's in his prize cards.
Yeah, that would be rough. Being able to turn off these special conditions is one of the first things you want to do to slow slow Seismitoad down to a halt.
Yeah, so this will be a big turn for Kyle. He's already gotten the Skyfield. That was a big thing. Darkrai EX coming into play. And what else is going to happen?
Yeah, I mean, he can get free retreat if he wants it, but decides, you know, I'm going to continue this strategy, try and put my opponent to sleep. If I can buy myself 1 turn of items, that would be great.
Yeah, so there we have.
Oh, passes. He actually put 3 counters, but he did change the stadium, so it is back down to 1. Jason, flipping the first tails on sleep. Now he's going to be desperately attempting to try and use some of these super scoop-ups, I'd think.
Oh, yeah, he has to go for that super scoop-up. But actually, Kyle did put Skyfield into play, so worst case scenario, Jason could Ultra Ball for another Shaman EX and draw some more cards.
Oh, and he hits the Super Scoop, so away Toad goes. And check it out, here's a fresh one. It's like nothing ever happened.
Yeah, that's right. So another Seismitoad EX comes out. There are a lot of coin flips that will decide this game, but, I mean, there are so many of them that they kind of average out over the course of the game. But, yeah, you can go on some streaks where, you know, if Jason stayed asleep and then flipped tails on Super Scoop Up and then, you know, couldn't find a way to get out of the active spot, he wouldn't be able to Quaking Punch.
And the way Jason's deck is built, he probably could have done some other things. Ultra Ball for another Shaman since he has room in the Sky Field and maybe find an AZ or some other tool. But if you can't do that for 1 turn, it can make all the difference.
Yeah, so there we do see another setup, getting the 6th benched Pokemon there thanks to Sky Field. I noticed he does have Verbank City Gym in his hand. He'll probably end up playing that at some point. But first, we're going to see a trump card.
And here we go. Same old song and dance. both players shuffling their entire discard pile back into their deck.
Right. Now, I am curious to see. I'm pretty sure Jason has Verbank City Gym in his hand. He might put that down this turn. I would assume he'll do that just to get that poison damage ramped up.
Yeah, Aegislash, while it hasn't taken much, will go down eventually to poison. Both players sort of content with this slow game, but Jason definitely doing giving Kyle a lot more trouble than he's seen in the past. He's not used to that double Absol knockout.
Yeah, definitely not. So this is going to continue to be kind of a slow game, a very methodical pace where, I mean, Aegislash EX with that Mighty Shield again. A great way to wall against those Seismitoad EX that don't play any basic energy cards. So, I mean, Jason, he's slowly taking an advantage.
So Kyle draws. Oh, another item. I can't use that. Quaking Punch, still so strong.
Yeah, so we do see, I mean, a lot of cards that Kyle can't play, and he's actually just going to pass.
Not even an energy.
Wow, yeah, he did have a double colorless energy. He could have played down onto Malamar again, but looks like he's just holding on to it.
Yeah, curious about that play. I mean, at this point, you want to do anything you can to maybe end that lock, right?
Yeah, I think so. Maybe he's trying to hold on to it for something. Maybe he wants to Sky Return with Shaman EX to try to draw some more cards with setup. There's all sorts of options.
Yeah, it's true. I mean, he has got plenty of time. Aegislash, while taking the poison damage, is still a mighty wall.
Yeah. So we see another Ultra Ball from Jason. He's going to be searching for a Pokemon. Probably the two choices here are Dragalge and Shaman. And then he'll be able to use setup again if he gets another Shaman EX. I think he really needs to start getting some of those hammers, discard those Prism Energy off of Malamar EX, and then maybe get Verbank City Gym going. To speed up the process a little bit. You can't knock out Aegislash doing 10 at a time. It's just going to be way too slow.
Oh, yeah. And Jason still having so many options available to him. I mean, really, he has almost his whole deck after he just shuffled it back in. He's going to be able to hopefully start getting rid of those energy one at a time, hopefully even both at a turn.
Yeah, so we see double colorless energy going on to that Shaman EX, and there we see the Shaman cramming onto the bench.
The whole Shaman crew is here. We got four. Super Scuba. Ooh, we got a hammer, computer search. We could see the double energy discard this turn.
Those were some pretty good draws off of that setup. And again, I don't believe he's played a supporter card this turn yet.
Hammer There's flip. Ooh, heads.
Yeah, so that is the name of the game here for Jason. Deny Kyle his energy. And, keep using Quaking Punch.
Now he is in sort of a Mayday mode. Jason can get any card out of his deck, perhaps even Enhanced Hammer, guaranteeing that second discard. It is his game to win.
Yeah. Now, there's also an interesting dynamic here with Skyfield. Jason, at this point, has used all four Shaman EX, but if he counters the Stadium, he'll be able to discard two of those Pokemon, which means he could discard two Shaman EX and then play Lysander's Trump card, shuffle them back in, and use them again.
It's wild how many times you can play Shaman in the game.
It's a revolving door of Shaman. So right, there we do see this play coming in. Verbank City Gym replacing the Sky Field, putting the two Shaman EX into the discard pile, and those can be reused later if we see that trump card.
I'll be back, says Shaman.
Yes. And Jason still has more cards to play. He has Computer Search. We may see him find Enhanced Hammer with that.
And then he has a Sycamore on top of it all.
Yeah. So, again, we can see some pretty lengthy turns now that Shaman EX is around. And, yeah, you can see just why Seismitoad EX has been so powerful at this tournament and so popular. You just get to do so much to disrupt your opponent.
Yeah. I mean, it's... Some might consider the perfect lock. One of the strongest disruptive cards we've ever seen in the history of Pokemon.
Yeah.
Even though it seems like not that powerful of an attack, Quaking Punch, it has the help of so many other cards. It seems like every time a set comes out, Toad gets a new piece of the puzzle.
Oh, and he actually opts for a Dragalge here. That poison barrier will prevent Aegislash EX from retreating. So you're probably thinking, okay, this card's a little bit of a nuisance. Let's try to get rid of it.
Yeah, well, now it's locked in the active position, and until Kyle can find some kind of Rizian combo, Aegislash is going to fall eventually.
Yeah. Now, we did see Kyle draw a Rainbow Energy for the turn, so he can play that down, maybe go for another Hyper Hypnosis play, and potentially stop Seismitoad EX, but now he's actually passing the turn again.
Interesting. Why do you think he's holding his energy instead of playing them?
I think he just... I mean, Aegislash is great and all for, stopping damage, but it's kind of slowing him down. He's not able to actually attack with anything because Slash Blast costs 3 energy, 4 with the Head Ringer. So he's kind of like, okay, I just want this thing to get knocked out.
Well, it's getting there at 120 damage now.
Yeah. Just, you know, two more turns of that Verbank and Poison will end up being a knockout. So now we see a Trainer's Mail from Jason. He's looking at the top four cards to be able to pick one of those Trainer cards. Looks like he's opting for Crushing Hammer. Pretty good choice if he can start whittling away that energy on Malamar EX.
Nothing makes you happier in this matchup than saying, hey, my opponent has no energy on their side of the field.
So, yeah, we might see him play that this turn. Both players have been a little conservative with the kind of cards they're playing. We see Jason, he could have used Trainer's Mail last turn. He does have two in his hand now. He could have used it to kind of dig for these hammers and extend and try to discard those energy on the previous turn, but kind of figured, you know what, I don't think anything's going to attack me, so I'll just sit back and wait.
Over the years, I've seen Jason Kluczynski is classically conservative in the way that he plays. He never likes to overextend his resources.
Yeah. I don't even know if I would describe it as conservative, but he's always very patient. He has a very good understanding of the timing of how things work. Understands, no, I don't need to do this turn. Many players would just try to burn through their deck as much as possible, but Jason sometimes can analyze it and say, you know what? Why don't I just sit back and let things develop?
Oh, yeah. And no one knows patience like Jason. All the Pokemon and all the poker.
So there we see a second Lysander's trump card. Let's shuffle them all back in again. This time, it is worth noting, Kyle only shuffles in two cards. That's really all he's been able to play in that amount of time.
He's been locked out completely. And this is probably an uncomfortable position for Kyle. He's never had this much trouble with a Toad before.
Yeah. I mean, he is having trouble. He's probably going to fall down three prizes in this game once the Aegislash EX goes down, but it is far from over. We've seen Kyle kind of dominate Seismitoad decks by denying prizes in those right situations, so I wouldn't count him out by any means.
So once again, we see a swap for the Skyfield. I'm just trying to do the math. There's 150 on Aegislash now, passes.
Yeah, that was a clever play. He's been holding on to that Skyfield just so Aegislash EX won't get knocked up by poison damage going back into Jason's turn.
Yeah, definitely the right call.
Yeah. But again, he doesn't attach energy from his hand. I really wonder what kind of strategy he's going for.
Yeah, I mean, even though they're susceptible to the hammers, I feel like you might as well try, right? I mean, the energy keep getting cycled back into your deck with all of these trump cards. Maybe you can leave Toad asleep for a turn if Jason can't get it out of the way.
Yeah, but again, he can afford to be patient. He's not going to lose the game in a couple turns. Quaking Punch takes quite a few turns to get knockout. So, you know, if you can sit back and wait, if you feel like you can afford to sit back and wait, that's not a big deal.
Absolutely. Now, Jason is...
Speaking of Absol.
Absol. Oh, man. The last time I made that pun at Nationals a couple years ago, I was booed by the crowd.
So rightfully so, Josh.
Hey, you brought it up this time. Where are the boos for Kyle?
They've all left the building.
It's been a long day, Pokemon.
Yeah, so we do have a Muscle Band going on to Shaymin EX. I wonder if Jason was eyeing up that AZ. Could be used to pick up Absol and reused Cursed Eyes and kind of torture Kyle even more, moving damage away from Aegislash EX and making sure it's not knocked out.
What a brutal play. Kyle feels like he's finally set it up so that his Aegislash is going to finally fall, but double on Toad.
Yeah, it looks like...
Prepare for trouble and make it double. Yeah. There we go. Got it. Got it.
Yeah, you nailed it. Puts the double colus on Absol.
I mean, to retreat it, maybe he's afraid of some kind of...
So he's going to play the Professor Sycamore, and that means if he plays a super scoop-up, he's probably going to want to pick up Absol, which means the double colus will go back to his hand.
Sort of conserves it within the game.
Yeah, instead of just discarding it, why not give yourself a chance to bring it back to your hand?
All right, and another Quaking Punch for zero, but the poison finally does it. Aegislash hits the discard pile after a long time of suffering.
170 damage was dealt through only poison.
So now Kyle has finally attached an energy, putting it on Trevenant and dealing 40.
Yeah, he just goes with the 40 damage attack. I mean, it's damage at least. I don't think he's done any of that so far. That might actually be his first attack of the game.
Yeah.
So at least he's starting to get some damage, but I mean, it's only 40 We know Jason plays Super Scoop Up. You know, he plays AZ. So, I mean, that'll add up at some point, but by the time you do enough, it might just be scooped up.
I think I understand Kyle's reasoning to an extent. I think his idea here is, well, if this one energy remains in the field, I can slap a double down and then Wood Blast for the knockout.
Yeah.
But Jason just runs so many different tools, you know. He could even play a supporter to discard this energy if he has, like, the grunt in hand or something along those lines.
Yeah, interesting spot for sure. We saw Jason go to play a Lysander and then rethinking his position. He could bring out something like that Seismitoad EX since he does have Dragalge out. But he's going to Hypnotoxic Laser the active and Xerosic. Discarding that Prism Energy.
Just mentioning those supporters that can discard. Now Kyle sort of loses that little trick. Like, ah, surprise, Wood Blast.
Yeah.
It's again, I'm just still wondering why he hasn't piled energy on just in case. I would rather, I guess, take the risk than go one at a time. Here we go. Speaking of one at a time.
And we're going to see another Dark Forest for 40 damage. Seismitoad EX now has 100 HP left. Really still not in any danger of being knocked out. All right, so Jason's turn once again. Of course, he's going to be looking to find some way to discard an energy off Kyle's field. Maybe that Versus Seeker for Xerosic is an option. If he can just continually remove energy every time one gets played, I mean, that's going to go a long way to just making sure Kyle can't attack.
We haven't seen a Shaman in a while, but you can see why Jason doesn't need it. He has a humongous hand. He's just been stockpiling these resources. Unless Kyle can find something like an N, he runs one, I suppose. Jason can continually remove energy sort of at his will.
Right. So this is a very systematic game so far. We've seen Kyle pretty much pick apart Seismitoad decks all day, but now he's run into Jason, who's maybe approaching this a little bit differently. Maybe Kyle's not drawing the cards in the right order he needs to. It's just been a much different feel than it was when he played against Aaron.
Huh. Versus Seeker Xerosic, he actually opts to discard the one off the Malamar.
Yeah, I actually love that play because if Kyle wants to commit a double colorless energy and Wood Blast, well, another Quaking Punch next turn is just going to knock that thing out. So why not? You discard the energy off Malamar. Sure, you give up two prizes, but who cares? You're just going to knock out the thing with all the energy. It's effectively using your Xerosic the best way possible.
True. And looking at Kyle's board, you know, what does he even promote after this once the Trevenant EX falls?
Yeah. Shaman?
Yeah, 2 for 30. It's looking real tasty.
Right.
Yeah.
So Jason put himself in an excellent position there. I think most players would have gone with the Xerosic on the active and say, no, don't knock me out. But he is just removing all energy in play. He's getting greedy.
Yeah, I mean, hey, sometimes greed works when you already have this much of an advantage.
Oh, yeah. So we will see a Quaking Punch for a knockout at some point, taking out Trevenant EX, and Jason will go down to one prize card. That's scary territory for Kyle. He's been able to deny prizes extremely well against these Seismitoad decks, but he's just been struggling this time.
The only thing that can really save you in some of these lopsided games is Jason Kluzinski with one prize card left. Maybe Kyle can hit an N and finally drop him to a low hand size. But otherwise, Jason can sort of run with it.
Yeah. Do see a couple more Seismitoad EX come into play. We could see an interesting play with Super Scoop Up here if Jason could pick up that Absol and move three damage counters away. Maybe set up a knockout on Jirachi EX next turn.
He even gets his double colorless back.
Yeah. So we're going to see Team Flare Grunt going to go ahead and just play that. You might think, why in the world would he do that? He's just going to get the knockout anyway. He just doesn't want to draw that card again in case an end gets played.
Sure, yeah. That's just an interesting little consistency play that you won't see often. But Jason, you know, he likes thinking about the worst case scenario and how can I avoid what happens in the worst case scenario.
That's right. So we are going to see Seismitoad EX hit the board for Kyle. And he will actually promote Shaman and use Sky Return. He's going to hope that he can start using Quaking Punch on Jason and maybe disrupt him a little bit.
Now, at Jason's, I'm reading, how many of those flare tools does he run? Does he run them?
Two.
Okay, he's got the two. I know we've seen them earlier. He would love to slap that down on Toad and just forever prevent sort of the Quaking Punch back in his favor. But also, you know, Kyle needs to knock out two Pokemon EX. Jason just needs one more prize card, period.
Yeah. It's going to be a very strange situation here. Jason only running those four double colorless energy. There's one on the active Seismitoad EX, one on the discard pile already, and then those two in play on Absol and Shaymin EX. So he really needed this super scoop up heads here. He got it. Now he has another energy left in play.
Yeah, and he can apply that wherever he likes.
Yeah.
Probably another Toad.
Yeah, it is going to get a little dicey for Jason. He is going to play that Lysander, though, which is going to slow Kyle down once again. That'll prevent any opportunity for a Quaking Punch next turn. But at this point, yeah, the energy is pretty limited for Jason, so we could see some clever plays from Kyle with that Zero Sick to discard a double colorless energy, a Lysander to bring up a Seismitoad that doesn't have any energy on it. There are ways for him to break the lock at this point.
Well, if he has a Hypnotoxic Laser, he can get within 10 damage. Well, he needs the stadium as well, but even with a Hypnotoxic Laser, he could have maybe kept Jirachi in a place where it can't retreat because of the Drag Algae. Doesn't have one here, but still 50 damage on Jirachi. All Jason needs is another Lysander, and he can just pull Jirachi up and call it game.
Yeah, this is really crazy to see. Like we've been saying, Kyle has just had an incredible run against Seismitoad EX decks, and he's been picked apart a little bit here in this first game.
Yeah, not even really sure what to do. He attaches and retreats and passes. I would almost concede at this point just to start throwing it to game two.
I don't even think he'll need to, though. There's the Versus Seeker for Lysander.
Yep.
Brings Jirachi back out in Quaking Punch for that last knockout. Wow.
And Kyle dropping a game to Toad. Definitely not something he's used to. But this is Jason Klasinski we're talking about.
That's right. He's a three-time world champion for a reason. He is the best of the best. And no surprise to see him doing this well in this tournament right here. It's actually been quite a few years since he's won this regional championship, so I'm sure he would love to be able to do that.
Oh, yeah. I've talked to him. He's plenty hungry for it, and he feels very confident. He's been playing Seismitoad variants throughout the year, and he feels especially good about this one.
Yeah. Now, if you're Kyle in this situation, a lot of time has gone by in that first game. You do have 75 minutes, but you got to think since that game took so long, you're probably not going to get to all three games. You probably have to pick up the pace and try to win this second one pretty quickly.
Yeah, I mean, all he can hope for is maybe something similar to his last round game two, where he won in about three turns.
Yeah, things can change very quickly. You know, if we see Kyle get a quick Quaking Punch on Jason this game, we've seen how quickly those Seismitoad decks can fall apart.
All right. Both players are shuffling up. They're getting ready for game two. But, man, Jason is in such a good position to put himself in the finals once again.
Yeah. At this point, Josh, who do you think is the favorite to win this series?
I mean, it's rough. Had you asked me at any other point, you know, who wins this matchup, we've seen Kyle sort of dismantle these Toad decks, but Jason Klasinski is one of the best Toad players in the world. It's just so hard to beat him, and he really has all of the momentum because he won that game one at a very slow pace, and he can obviously drag this second game out just naturally by playing the cards that are available to him.
Yeah, so it looks like the players are setting up for game number two. Hopefully we'll get that to you in a second and get back to the top four of the Madison, Wisconsin Regional Championship.
All right, you see Jason, he looks pretty much unfazed. Every time I talk to him between a tournament, he's just calm, collected. He's played Pokemon pretty much longer than anyone else. So he's just, this is just a daily routine for him.
I've heard one of my friends call him the Pokemon robot because he can just play and play and play and he hardly ever makes a mistake.
The crazy thing is he'll like finish a tournament and just be like, hey, anybody want to play more Pokemon? That's all. Like, he's always down for a game.
Yeah, someone who truly loves the game. All right, Kyle's going to start this game off much differently this time. Finds that Regirock with that Omega Barrier Ancient trait. So already this is going to be a much different game.
Yeah, turns everything around. All those hammers could potentially be useless as he attaches to Regirock once at a time.
Yeah, also, Jason starting off with Absol. Definitely not the Pokemon you want to start off with.
Oh, no.
Does not have Quaking Punch, so you already don't want to start with it.
Yeah, but yeah. I'm reading it. It actually says Mach Claw, not Quaking Punch. I see 2 for 30, but no.
Yeah. But it does not play any Darkness energy, so cannot use that attack. Not that he would want to anyway.
No, but he also does lose, I guess, the immediate Cursed Eyes that he could maybe search for with an Ultra Ball later. So he sort of has to just be content with maybe Super Scooping it later.
Yeah, in order to attack on the first turn with Quaking Punch, he'll have to find that Super Scoop up and flip heads or one of those AZ.
So we do see an immediate end on Kyle's part. We know how much he loves playing that turn one Pokemon Fan Club, and we actually just see a pass, no energy.
Yeah, so Looks like it'll be on Jason's turn. Kyle didn't get to do a whole lot, but again, he can afford to be patient, especially with Regirock out there. As long as he can get Aromatisse into play at some point, Regirock can protect all the energy until he's ready to build up an attacker. And if you're Jason, you have to be aggressive. You probably have to get a Quaking Punch right now.
Yeah, and it's still not out of the question. He is going to need to find a few things, but that's why he runs four Shaman to find them, and he might have to hit a flip.
Yeah. So Ultra Ball is going to start this off. He'll discard those two cards and search for a Pokemon. He could go for a Shaman EX. He could go for maybe the Seismitoad EX. Looks like he may have a computer search as well, so it's going to start off pretty well for him as long as he can find that Super Scoop Up.
Oh, yeah. He can check his deck, see what's prized, and it's even though, you know, you're starting Absol, like, oh, man, in a previous world, you know, if you start your non-Toad in the Toad matchup, you're probably not getting your Quaking Punch. Now, though, when you can draw through so many cards and activate so many different ways to stop your opponent while helping yourself, it's not out of the question at all.
Yeah, so Ultra Ball. Looks like Jason is looking at Shaman EX right now. Of course, he just wants to be able to draw more and more cards with setup. That way, maybe he can draw into Super Scoop Up, find a Seismitoad EX, find a Double Colossus Energy, and start using Quaking Punch right away.
Oh, yeah. You can't say no to a setup. The question, though, is do you say no to the computer search or not? You know, he can discard two cards from his hand and then get a bigger setup. But what is he going to – maybe he can hold it in case he finds Toad otherwise, can search for the double. We'll see what he does here.
Yeah, he also has a Trainer's Mail. He can go ahead and play that, see what he gets off of those four cards, and go from there.
All right, so we do see an option between Stadiums and Hammers. Nothing helping him immediately. Maybe swapping the Stadium is okay, but probably not the Trainers he wanted to see.
Yeah, he actually has that AZ in his hand, so he could pick up Absol. The problem is he doesn't have the Seismitoad EX and also the Double Colossus Energy, so just using AZ on your Absol and passing is not a very good turn.
No, not quite. The question is, you know, how risky do you go here? You could maybe play the computer search now just to throw Toad down, make sure it's there, draw a lot of cards of Shaman, try and pray for the double. Or do you hold the computer search, play Shaman for a few less cards, and hope that you can use the computer search to find a double?
Yeah, I think you probably play the computer search here. The difference between drawing six and three cards is monumental. And plus, you already have more Shaman EX in your deck to keep drawing cards. You have the Trainer's Mail to dig for more Trainer cards. So I feel like computer search and getting six fresh cards with Shaman is probably the best option.
Oh, do you think then he doesn't even hold the AZ?
Yeah, I think he's going to... Yeah, that's an interesting spot, but it looks like he's going to computer search the Headringer and the AZ, probably grab a Seismitoad EX with this, drop down that Verbank, and go from there.
Yeah, I mean, you can't say no to a six fresh card play. Still hasn't played the supporter either. And, you know, even discarding the AZ isn't so bad because it's not unthinkable that he could find one of his four Versus Seeker.
That's right. This is probably the optimal play for him at this point to get that turn one Quaking Punch. And if he can, I mean, he'll shut down item cards as soon as the first turn.
And all Kyle can do is wait, you know, sort of sitting there grinning like, oh, man, I've done so much hate to Toad, but it looks like it's all coming back.
Yeah. He's probably thinking, how much time we got left here? Turn's taking a little bit of time here.
Yeah, it's rough when all you can do is wait. So here we see, actually opting, he grabbed another Shaman, I think, off of his computer search.
That's a good option as well, right? I mean, you just draw more cards.
Yeah, I mean, Jason, while the rest of his hand is not so stellar, he does have an Ultra Ball, so now he can Ultra Ball, Toad, Shaman, try and find the double, all that good stuff.
Yeah. So we see Ultra Ball discarding that Lysander and maybe a Versus Seeker since he does have a couple of those already. So this will almost definitely find a Seismitoad EX.
Oh, man. Are you telling me that the Shaman we're about to see is just Shaman number two?
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
Yep, setup has no limit. As long as you can put a Shaman onto your bench, you can use setup.
What a powerful card.
Yeah, as many as you want in a turn. Even if you Super Scoop Up, you could do even more.
Oh, yeah. We're looking at a world where Jason could play, like, nine Shaman in one turn.
Yeah, four Super Scoop Up and AZ.
I don't want to live in this world anymore.
All right, so there we do see Seismitoad EX going onto the bench, still in quest of that turn one quaking punch. He at least gets a Seismitoad down. That is one step of the equation here. Gonna drop down, looks like Hypnotoxic Laser. Start getting the poison out of that Darkrai EX.
Never a terrible first turn play.
Yeah. So there's Seismitoad. We'll probably see another setup for five.
Looking for that double still. He's got AZ, Hammers, another Super Scoop up. Oh, and the double last card. There it is. I mean, he already has a guaranteed Quaking Punch turn one if he just plays the AZ, but he could even still just hit the Super Scoop up heads.
Yeah, it looks like he's going to go for that. He would prefer to be able to play a Professor Sycamore, dig for a Muscle Ban in this situation. But there's the AZ. Going to pick up that Absol, promote Seismitoad EX, and here we go. The first turn is about to come to an end, Josh.
All that for one Quaking Punch.
Yes, all that for 30 damage.
But, you know, it's the most crucial 30 damage of the game. You know. By the way, I was thinking about it. Did Kyle have a single turn of items that last game?
I mean, his first turn.
Wow.
You always get at least one.
Well, I meant, once the Toadlock started, did it ever fall?
I don't think he got a single one after Quaking Punch started. That's something Jason excels at. If he uses Quaking Punch, he's going to use Quaking Punch for the rest of the game. He's going to keep in mind any possible option Kyle has for slowing him down.
So we do see, Kyle just sort of like, what do I do now? Maybe draw some cards, try and create this Aromatisse. I really need to pick up the pace, hopefully. There's not much he can do other than just try and set up as quickly as possible.
Speaking of setup, I'm going to draw three cards from the Shaman EX.
Toad is one of his favorites, but he doesn't even have an energy.
No, looks like Kyle once again falling victim to Quaking Punch, unable to draw the right cards.
And that can be one of these rough things. When you run a deck with so many different cards, it isn't always consistent. Kyle himself has called it clunky.
We're going to see this play again. Cursed Eyes onto the Spritzy, and we even have a Versus Seeker for that AZ to reuse Cursed Eyes. Two games in a row, Jason is able to use that Absol and take a knockout on Spritzy. This is an incredible usage of this utility card.
Such a strong card. And, I bet you when Jason started adding Absol into the deck, he wasn't thinking about the double Spritzy. But, as soon as it's in, he's very good at reading, the multiple uses of his cards.
Oh, yeah.
He certainly loves cards that allow him to move damage around. It's been a popular play. He loves those one-off tech cards. And,
Jason is excellent at playing an extremely simple deck and adding one or two cards that add an incredible amount of options. And Absol is a perfect example of that.
It's actually kind of ironic to me because his world-winning Darkrai deck chose not to play the Absol that everybody else played. So now this is Jason's way of saying, hey, look, I can play an Absol and make it work.
Yeah, I know Jason was a huge fan of the old Absol EX with that Cursed Eyes Poke Power, but now we have in 2015 Absol with the Cursed Eyes ability, exact same effect.
It's a blast from the past.
Yep. And then we see a Super Scoop Up, and it will be a Tails. So he hasn't flipped well on those cards quite yet, but he doesn't need to. AZ has been doing all the work.
So Jason, I would say once again, he's really put himself in the perfect position. All Kyle can really do is smile it off, but it's got to be a little bit frustrating after you've crushed so many Toads to sort of be in one of the worst Toad positions you've been in.
Yeah, so we see another Quaking Punch, just 30 damage. Jason unable to find any Muscle Band or Verbank City Gym to improve his position here, maybe get some extra damage there. But I think he's got to be pretty happy with how things are going. He took down a Spritzy, but here comes another one with that Pokemon Fan Club.
Is Virizion EX prized again?
I'm not sure. Looking through the deck here.
I haven't seen it this time.
Looking for that beautiful full art Virizion EX, and I don't see it anywhere.
Oh, that's rough. Now he's got a weird spot. It's like, do I attach to the Regirock to keep the energies alive, or do I attach to the Malamar and hope that sleep thing works once?
Yeah, that is an interesting choice. Man, he only has a double colors energy, it looks like. I can't see if he has a rainbow or a prism. So Malamar hitting the board, and we'll probably see. Well, he's got a debate. Do I want to put down Spritzy?
Actually, opting to attach to the Seismitoad, but, oh, man, the way Jason has the board, I would not be surprised to see that energy go away. Here's the flip. Do it. Tails there. Here's a second flip to do it.
And?
Ooh, off the table there.
Oh, man. Here it goes.
Another Tails.
I don't know if Jason's flipped heads. in this game.
You know, but
maybe once.
You don't really need to, though, when you have things like the Xerisic, the Grunt, the Enhanced Hammer, which has no flip.
Yeah, and Jason is pretty concerned with Kyle being able to use Quaking Punch. He knows how important those item cards are to his own deck, so he wants to stop that at all costs. He has his Professor Sycamore and wants to find a Hammer or a Headringer. Either one of those could potentially stop that Quaking Punch from happening to him.
No hammers in that hand, however. He did have an Ultra Ball. Probably going to try and blow resources away and play Shaman, try and draw it. If that energy remains there, Kyle's Quaking Punch could turn the game around.
Right. So yeah, Jason's definitely going to dig and dig and dig until he can find something to slow down Kyle's Quaking Punch, because we've seen how devastating it is. We saw last round against Aaron, where game two, Kyle just got that quick Quaking Punch, and Aaron just drew and passed the rest of the turns because, well, your deck is so reliant on item cards.
So here we do see an Ultra Ball. Jason opting to discard at least one Hypnotoxic Laser. Not an extremely helpful card to him since Darkrai is already poisoned.
Right. And then we see a double Colossus Energy. Jason also opted to put the double Colossus Energy on his active. Has two of them in case of that Xerisic. That's a possibility. Figures it's more useful there than putting it on Shaman or Absol.
Oh, yeah. And Kyle does run the Xerisic.
Yeah.
So it is a nice surprise play at times, but Jason even trying to play around surprises.
Yeah, so here we see Ultra Ball. He's actually grabbing Skrelp in here. He's determined that maybe Dragalge could be useful. And I don't blame him, right?
Yeah.
He hasn't seen Virizion EX from Kyle at all in
no.
either of these games. So he might not think he plays it. And if that's the case, if you don't have Virizion EX, Dragalge is huge to just trap things in place.
And he does at least, I know, have the Dragalge in hand. Kyle's just going to have one turn where maybe he can retreat this Darkrai. And Jason, first the Seeker for the that Team Flare Grunt.
Yeah, he knows a Quaking Punch is likely to happen, so he just wants to go ahead and prepare with that Team Flare Grunt.
Oh, and Kyle actually going right now with that Wally play to get Aromatisse out immediately. At least here he's not going to get the double Cursed Eyes.
Yeah, that was actually brilliant by Kyle. He could have benched the Spritzy on the previous turn, but, well, he knows Absol is an option. If he could do the double Cursed Eyes again, he just won't ever get Aromatisse in play because both Spritzy get knocked out. May as well hold on, wait till you can Wally, and boom, instant Aromatisse, but he doesn't have energy.
That's so rough, because he has so many great combos with the Aromatisse. You can attach to Malamar, activate the ability, move it over to Regirock to keep it safe afterwards, but he has none of that.
Oh, and there is the Dragalge, so Poison Barrier is going to stop that Darkrai EX from being able to retreat. Just one more dimension of that lock.
And while I'm not certain, I can only imagine with how often Kyle has gone for that Virizion EX that it's been prized both games, and that hurts so much when you're this far in.
Yeah, just that one card makes all of the difference. Verdant Wind, such a game-breaking ability against Hypnotoxic Laser, which is, for the most part, the main source of damage for a Seismitoad deck.
And it's also the main source of this Dragalge's ability, just keeping Darkrai locked in the active position.
Oh, and that's a huge play. The Muscle Band. This math is going to work out beautifully for Jason. A Quaking Punch will hit for 50, then 60, leaving Darkrai EX with just 10 HP. So then going back into Jason's turn, the poison damage will knock out Darkrai. And then Kyle will have to promote something else that can get hit by a Quaking Punch.
And that is often a player's greatest fear when they're playing against these decks that can poison. It's been a sort of math problem for the history of Pokemon. But getting knocked out when it's going into your opponent's turn is just the worst.
Oh, yeah. And Dragalge is going to make that possible. Even if Kyle had an opportunity to retreat, Poison Barrier is going to stop it.
Yeah, if he had just one, you know, some type of rainbow energy.
Oh, he just top decked the AZ.
Whoa, hey, there we go. All Jason could do is shake his head, like, wow.
Oh, my goodness. All of that work for nothing.
Wow, he did have that perfect setup. The only thing here, though, is Kyle is extremely susceptible to losing his energy. Jason did get that Team Flare Grunt for this
Jason
situation.
Draws the head ringer, which he would have loved to have seen just a turn or two ago. So things starting to go Kyle's way a little bit, but there is the zero sick discarding the double colorless energy and then another quaking punch from Jason.
After all that, what's Kyle going to do? He could have used that energy a long time ago.
Yeah.
Malamar gimmicks, here we go.
Hyper hypnosis going to put Seismitoad EX to sleep, potentially causing Jason to miss a quaking punch. But the bad news is Kyle will not use Quaking Punch this turn, so item cards are back as an option.
So for the first time in this matchup, Regirock does get a safe energy, and for the first time in a long while, Seismitoad actually remains asleep.
Yeah, and Jason, been hit by a hypnotoxic laser so many times in his life, he naturally thought he was poisoned.
He's like, oh, there's my poison damage. Oh, wait a second.
But that was a huge turn for Kyle. Even though he did not get to Quaking Punch, he did get to put Seismitoad EX to sleep. Jason has burned through a lot of those super scoop-ups so far, so there's a very good chance he won't be able to attack this turn.
Headringer, definitely a strong play, though. Unless Kyle has a double colorless energy, he's not going to be doing that really useful Quaking Punch. He does have a lot of other good combos, though. He can at least play the waiting game for a little while. He's got the Malamar to Regirock, all thanks to Aromatisse move.
Yeah, Jason is in a precarious situation. He has burned through a lot of resources. This is a turn where I think he needs to use that Lysander's trump card, shuffle in all those hammers. Otherwise, or even the super scoop-ups, otherwise he's going to be in a spot where Kyle's going to have the freedom to just start putting down more and more energy.
And I do believe I see a super scoop-up at the end of Jason's hand, so it's going to be a very flip-dependent turn.
Yeah, even if he does hit heads in the super scoop-up, he does need to put down a new Seismitoad EX to promote. Otherwise, he'd have to promote Shaman or Absol or Dragalge. And he can't attach twice to retreat and then power up Quaking Punch.
This is true. Did he just play an Ultra Bomb?
Yeah.
Okay, so he's probably going to try and find Shaman, fish some kind of miracle out.
I think he might go for the Seismitoad. I mean, if he already has a Super Scoop Up in hand.
Replacement Toad. Definitely.
Yeah, there we go. There's a Seismitoad EX. And yeah, we could see another game-breaking coin flip coming up.
One interesting thing, too, is if he does hit heads, he actually gets two double colors back into his hand.
So here we go.
He has a replacement double in hand as well.
Oh, and now it's time to count how many cards you have left. Am I going to deck out if I use Shaman's setup?
So Toad down, right. Super scoop up,
it's probably
humongous
the biggest
flip.
One so far.
Huge flip, and he gets heads.
There we go. There's the heads, picking up Seismitoad EX. Kyle, he was just starting to claw back, and oh, man, heads on super scoop up. Just out of reach again.
Yeah, Toad goes down, double. I actually don't know if Jason's hand... Oh, he has a Shaman at the end of all of this, too. I didn't realize he already had one. Oh, man.
Yeah.
And normally, you know, you'd look, okay, my opponent finally has a small hand, can't do much. Just kidding, there's a Shaman at the end of this tunnel, too.
So he'll be able to set up, it looks like, for four cards. I think he has to be looking for Lysander's trump card here.
Hard to see everything, but we just see a Versus Seeker. Has he discarded trump card at any point?
It's probably pretty likely. He's got most of his deck is in that discard pile. So good chance that there's one in there, but there's always the possibility that Lysander's trump card is in your prize cards. And if that's the case, Jason is running pretty low on cards.
Oh, that could be very dangerous. I don't often see Jason play himself into a situation where he could get decked out, but you never know.
Yeah, so here we do see Versus Seeker. Curious to see what he'll take in this situation. He could take another Zero Sick. He could take another AZ. All sorts of options.
Seeing him flip through, I actually don't see the trump card in there.
Yeah, I don't think we've seen one yet.
Only like four cards left in the deck. I wonder if it is in the deck, actually.
Yeah, it could just be that situation where you've drawn a bunch of cards, but you didn't draw the right ones.
All right, so we do see another Muscle Band on the second Toad, and another Quaking Punch.
Wow, okay, so just Quaking Punch, nothing else. And, oh, there's a Zero Sick. Kyle pulling this playoff again where he discards the Headringer off of his own Seismitoad EX. There we're going to see Hyper Hypnosis, Fairy Transfer moving the energy up, and we'll see a Quaking Punch from Kyle. Uh-oh.
Good stuff.
Here's a sleep
Jason
flip.
Jason flips Tails, too. I don't know. I mean, he's burned through. Did he opt to pick up the AZ, I think?
He did, yeah. He actually saw this coming and said, yeah, I might stay asleep. There's a possibility of that. gets the AZ back, and now he can just pick up Seismitoad EX and continue to use Quaking Punch.
Kyle has at least somewhat, I would say, turned the tables, giving himself at least one turn where he can't have to deal with Jason's items. You know, Jason can sort of reset these toads, but can he do it forever?
Yeah, the problem here for Jason is he can't get a knockout with Quaking Punch, and also Trevenant EX is looming. Now there are two Prism Energy in play. Just any energy now, Kyle can retreat, Fairy Transfer the energy over, and Wood Blast.
And since Seismitoad is not poisoned, it can still use Darkrai's Dark Cloak to retreat, and you know, he can use whatever, probably Trevenant, if he wants to get this knockout.
Yeah, this is going to be a huge turning point for Kyle. He has finally busted through that Seismitoad wall.
Oh, and the option is there. We've got three different Rainbowed Energies, all on Trevenant EX, and we see the Wood Blast for a knockout. Kyle takes two, and Jason has to promote something undesirable.
Yeah, this is not a great spot. I'm surprised Jason didn't put that other Seismitoad EX back down on his bench. There was space with Skyfield. Now he'll have to promote something he really doesn't want to.
Yeah, and I'm not sure. You know, he's played through so many Super Scoop-Ups and AZs and other like tools. Can he move this and even continue the lock?
I don't think so. I think it stops here. And, man, again, he's running low on cards. He could be running out.
Can you imagine the patience that is required? You have to do all of that waiting to finally turn the game into your favor. Oh, I can't even imagine how maddening it is. Right. But just like that, I would actually say Kyle's in a good spot. Does get hit with an enhanced hammer, though, losing one of his special energy.
Right, but he's at that point where he has enough. Right, if you can keep two energy in play, usually you can just attach another one and start using Wood Blast again.
The second this double hits the Shaman, that means that the lock is done.
Yeah, we see Jason has Professor Sycamore, but if he plays it, he'll immediately lose because he'll have no cards left in his deck. I really think this is the spot where he just has not drawn Lysander's trump card yet. He only has quite a few cards left, and it's sitting in there somewhere.
Yeah. Can you imagine it'd be sitting? You want to draw it. You could draw it if you play Sycamore, but then you deck out the next turn. He's sort of in top deck mode, and it's just such a dangerous space to be in.
Yeah, at this point, I think Kyle has taken complete control of this game. He is well in the lead. I mean, if he gets a Lysander this turn, he could bring out a Shaman EX, take another knockout on a Pokemon EX. There we do see Versus Seeker. So it is a possibility.
Would not be surprised to see Lysander.
No, actually going to go for AZ. So he's going to scoop up that Seismitoad EX. Just says, you know what? He could either Quaking Punch, which looks like that's what he's going to go for, or continue to Wood Blast. Quaking Punch is the more patient route, and Kyle seems to love taking his sweet time. He's going to go ahead and do that, realizing that, well, if I just Quaking Punch, you really can't do anything.
Yeah, and his energies remain safe on the Regirock. The question is, you know, how much time is left? He still has to complete this game, but he's certainly in the means to do so.
Yeah. Well, we are in the top cut, so if you take at least four prize cards, the game will count. So if Kyle can take just one or two more prize cards, he can make this game count, and we will, you know, probably guarantee a game three because Jason does not look to be in the best of shape right now.
Oh, yeah. No, he would certainly love, obviously, some kind of play where he can just and end the day with some kind of Lysander.
That's right. So let's see what Jason can do. Looks like nothing. Another Quaking Punch going to knock out that Absol. Jason promotes the Shaman EX. Kyle has taken complete control. Still no Lysander's trump card. What is happening?
Oh, man. Is it the last card in his deck, or did he just truly never get it?
I don't know. we're in a situation here where Kyle now has three Prism Energy. They're safe on that Regirock EX, Omega Barrier, preventing any sort of trainer cards from affecting his situation. Aromatisse can move energy wherever he wants. Darkrai gives free retreat. Trevenant EX can knock out anything on the field. This is just a matter of time, it seems like. Kyle waited so long to get in this position, but once he did, Jason has fallen apart.
Wow. It's funny, because Jason just started, I would almost argue, even hotter than the first game. Just seemed like he had everything. Once again, no Virizion EX that you have to deal with. Oh, my goodness. Is he going for the Grenade Hammer here?
Busting out the Grenade Hammer for the second time today.
I mean, he has the energy for it. Still has extra energy on the Regirock. All Jason can do is promote Dragalge, and what's the last card that he draws?
Not Lysander's trump card.
Prized.
Yep.
Oh, brutal. The only thing Jason can do is play N and perhaps not draw the rest of his deck just to not deck out, but the game is essentially over.
Yeah, I think so. I don't think there's much Jason could do at this point. Man, even if he has any sort of hammer, it will not stop the grenade hammer. So, I mean, I guess he's just trying to do whatever he can. He does have a hypnotoxic laser that could buy some time if, well, he's going to set up for two cards. Draws two more Shaman EX.
This Brigade of Shaman is not going to turn it around. The game is over. And
I see him say, I concede. And we're going to move on to game number three, the top four of the Madison, Wisconsin Regional Championships. Even in such a long game, it's fun to see these players still in good spirits.
Oh, yeah. Big smile from Kyle. I can only imagine the relief. I mean, like we said, he built this deck to essentially beat Toads. And, man, do you have to take a beating before you can actually do it?
Yeah. I mean, we questioned early on, what was he doing? He's waiting a long time. It just took him so long to get everything set up. But then once he did, you could see you kind of get over the hump, and then it's all downhill from there. Once you had the ability to knock out Seismitoad EX in one hit, they really can't do very much about it.
Oh, yeah. That shifts the game completely. He was able to use the Regirock quite a bit this game just to keep his energy safe. He was also able to get an Aromatisse out. That single copy of Wally that he runs, putting in the work, allowing him to get around that double Absol play finally.
Yeah. Now, we're in game three, kind of a low-time situation. I would assume there's not a whole lot of time left in the round. Who do you think has the advantage now? We're in game three. Is it Jason or Kyle?
I mean, you'd think Jason, just because he's usually taking the first prize card in this matchup. Kyle's going to throw up some kind of wall and just let it fall. Most games, I'd say Jason's taking the first prize. It really depends, you know. Can he set up some kind of attacker quickly enough? It's hard to run down a Toad. A little bit easier, though, if you can enter the Quaking Punch mode.
Yeah. So this is something we'll have to find out. Also something to keep in mind, Jason's deck capable of taking some pretty long turns.
We're being told there's about 15 minutes left for this game. That's probably not enough for a complete one, but maybe enough for Kyle if he plays quickly enough to at least get into attack mode.
Yeah, and time limits are just an unfortunate part of living in the real world.
You mean we can't play Pokemon forever?
Unfortunately, no. We do have to leave the venue at some point. So we do have time limits in these matches, so that is something that tournament players have to keep in mind. You not only have to beat your opponent, but you have to beat the clock sometimes. So I think both these players are pretty experienced. They both understand the situation. It's just who's going to manage to come out on top.
All right, so it's a battle against each other, a battle against the clock, and we see both players just about ready to go to start drawing for game three of this heated top four regional match.
Tensions could not be higher at this point. These two players are playing one more game for a chance to play in the finals of this tournament and be crowned regional champion, get 150 championship points on top of all sorts of other great prizes. But those championship points will get you closer to that world championship invitation or even a spot in the top 16 where you can get great positioning at the world championship.
Oh, yeah. And with both these players seeming to have pretty solid seasons this year, I'm sure they're both, they've got worlds sort of on the mind.
Right. I know Jason already has his invitation to the World Championship. Not sure how Kyle's doing on championship points, but oh, no. Jason has an unplayable hand.
Shaman double. Whoa. That's looking like what we saw game two last matchup. That's exactly what Kyle wants to see. His energy are safe on Regirock, but he might even want to look for something more aggressive just to close it out. Look at that. It's like hammers and nothing and Dragalge, no supporter, no Ultra Ball. It's rare that Jason finds himself in this position. Oh, it's unplayable. I mean, he's fanning it over and over again. I'm trying to see like, okay, maybe there's one. Nope. He's in top deck mode on turn one.
Yeah, so we do see that level ball for Jirachi EX. Man, how many times has Kyle done this? Stellar Guidance for Pokemon Fan Club. Grabs two basic Pokemon, going for Spritzy and Seismitoad EX.
Oh, boy. Jason, can't imagine how frustrating that is. You go this deep in, you play so like with so much calculation, getting all the way here, and then one of these things happens. Especially with time on the line, you don't want this low of a start. What is he top deck? Ultra Ball,
ooh,
that's at least
okay.
Something to save him.
Yeah, now he has an interesting decision. He could Ultra Ball for Seismitoad EX and go for Quaking Punch. And now Jason's actually asking, can I play Crushing Hammer? You know, it won't have any use if they have Omega Barrier. Even if you flip heads, you can't discard the energy.
You can burn it, though, right?
Yes, you can. Yeah, you can play Crushing Hammer. There is an eligible energy to be discarded. So you can target the energy. It just won't be able to be discarded.
Just flipping the coin for the decoration of it. Even if it says it doesn't matter, that Omega Barrier. Look at Kyle. What a troll. Oh, here goes. Just kidding.
So Jason's going to go with the Ultra Ball, discarding Dragalge. And he's thinking, do I do Crushing Hammer or double colorless energy? Because he can play the Verbank.
Yeah. Definitely. Now the question is, do you put yourself in top deck mode, but grab the Toad for a guarantee?
Yeah, no way. I think he's
Shaman,
going right for that Shaman.
Just got to dig. I mean, that Ultra Ball top deck was very huge for him.
Yeah, he needed something this turn. Otherwise, he was going to be in a very bad spot next turn.
If he drew any of his other items, you know, Hypnotoxic Laser, another Hammer, he's just in draw pass, and that is a death sentence against this deck.
Yeah. If Kyle got a Quaking Punch next turn, that would almost be game over.
He's still threatening it, but yeah.
So here we do see Ultra Ball for that Shaman EX. Gets to use that setup ability once he plays it down onto the bench. And, we'll probably see a longer turn from there now that he has the ability to draw a lot of cards. Could see this turn into more Shaman and supporter cards and all that stuff. Jason definitely looking to get a Quaking Punch.
Oh, yeah. It's, it could be a battle of who takes the first prize card here as we're fighting against time. Jason could put the first damage on, but Kyle does have some interesting tricks. If he can find himself a Darkrai, he can continually retreat and sort of mitigate that damage.
Right. So here we go. This is going to be a huge setup for Jason. 5 cards. Can he draw the cards to get himself a Seismitoad EX?
Ooh, Ultra Ball, that's really all he needs. Not the best hand, though, because if he does Ultra Ball for the Toad, he has no other means of draw. So again,
this was simultaneously an incredibly good hand and an incredibly bad hand. So what Jason can do is Ultra Ball for Seismitoad. He has double colorless, Muscle Band, Lysander. He can knock out Spritzy. This will slow down Kyle a lot. He'll take the first prize, but then he'll be left with no other cards. So it's a very high-risk, high-reward kind of play. Or he could just go for another Shaman EX. I'm not sure which one he's going to do.
Yeah, I mean, at this stage, it certainly seems tempting to prevent the Aromatis as quickly as possible and go up in the prize trade, but you could be in top deck mode again. He has no draw supporter, no way to draw. He does get an extra card out of the prizes, which could help him.
I mean, his other option is to actually Sky Return. He would give up Quaking Punch so Kyle could use item cards. But if he does that same thing but uses Sky Return, he'll have the Shaman EX in his hand for next turn.
The thing is, he could... Oh, Sky Return still at the Muscle Band.
Right.
Still getting that same knockout.
I think that's probably... Oh, no, he's going all in.
Oh, all in the Toad. No cards in hand. Aside from this prize that he picks up, I can't see what he got.
Yeah, well, it looked like 2 Shaman EX were actually in his prize card, so he knows he has at least a 1-in-3 shot of getting a Shaman EX. But, oh, no,
Zerosic.
Oh, man. Things turning around for Kyle.
He has a replacement double and the biggest flip of the day.
Oh, my
Super
goodness.
Scoop up. And look at him. He could tell the gravity of the situation, and he hits
heads. Oh, my goodness.
A whole new hand. Wow, the risk pays off. That is dangerous.
Unbelievable. This is what it takes to win tournaments sometimes. Plays down that other double colorless. Set up for 6 fresh cards. You can see the difference between heads and tails there.
Oh.
0 cards and 6 cards. Now he gets a head ringer. Oh, my goodness.
Oh, man. That is brutal. If he hits tails, I would honestly say Jason is the candidate to lose here. He gets hit by a Quaking Punch in return. You know, he's in top deck mode all over again. Now he's got everything. Super scoops. He could maybe discard this 1 energy that's on the Toad. He can bide his time because he's up in prizes. That was the game.
Yeah, that was such an incredibly monumental flip there. You can't even put that into words.
Yeah.
At this point, though, the game is not over by any means. Jason had to burn through so many Crushing Hammers. We do see another heads on that Super Scoop Up. A lot of his hammers are gone, so he's going to have a tough time discarding Kyle's energy. And if Kyle can use Quaking Punch, that's still going to be difficult.
Oh, yeah. No, it just depends. Did Kyle have a double colorless in hand?
I'm not sure.
Hard to tell. He's going to need it, though, if he does want to play through that Headringer. Perhaps he has some sort of miracle, spritzy, Wally, Romatis movement play. But aside from that, his Quaking Punch is going to be a little less likely.
Yeah, now Jason recognizing all those Crushing Hammers are in the discard pile. He needs to use that Lysander's trump card, shuffle them all back in. He's kind of banking on the fact that Kyle won't get a Quaking Punch next turn so that he can start throwing out those Crushing Hammers.
Right, so both players, they've refreshed everything. Jason obviously getting a bit more out of this deal.
Yeah.
And, well, wasn't prized this game.
Yeah. And he also has Shaman EX. He could use setup if he really wants. Yeah. I think that's a good idea. Try to find one of those hammers.
It's not out of the question that he finds one of the hammers he just put right back in. Let's see. Yeah. Don't see it there, but another Ultra Ball means potentially another Shaman.
Right. Even a Hypnotoxic Laser would be a big play here, potentially keeping that Seismitoad EX asleep if he flips heads and then Kyle flips tails. There are a lot of different item cards Jason can draw here to put himself in a more advantageous position.
So we do see the Ultra Ball discards. And it's to his benefit to play as many cards as possible while he's up in the prize trade.
So here we do see that Ultra Ball. I thought two Shaman EX were prized before. That might be the case. If it is, he won't be able to use setup. And
Skrelp.
Goes for the Skrelp.
Didn't find it out of the prizes that he drew. Hmm. So we might not see any kind of hammering this turn.
Wow. So, yeah, gets the Skrelp. Dragalge has been fairly useful for him in this matchup. Of course, the last game it was almost good, and then AZ came in for Kyle and ruined that whole poison barrier lock.
That top deck might have changed the entire game.
Oh, yeah. But now we just had that 50 damage Quaking Punch. This is a huge turn for Kyle.
Oh, top decks the double. Oh, the grossness of it all.
Oh, my goodness.
Slaps the double down.
All over the place, Josh.
Sycamore. Oh, boy. Both of these players pulling out all stops to close this one out. And Kyle able to respond with his own Quaking Punch for less damage, but it does allow him to set up. And the stadium swap as well.
Now, Jason's Quaking Punch has a big impact. It shuts off Kyle's item cards and... I mean, that it's a big deal, but Kyle using Quaking Punch has a much bigger impact on Jason since his deck is like half item cards. Like, pretty much he won't be able to play half of his cards anymore, but oh, there's a Zero Sick discarding that double colorless.
That's such a useful supporter card. Even though it might seem like it has a weaker effect for a supporter, being able to play it through Seismitoad's Lock is what makes the difference. And I don't know if Kyle has a replacement double for another miracle.
See, kind of... One-upping each other in this kind of a situation. Jason getting the super scoop-up heads, and Kyle top-decking that double colorless. And then Jason going with the Zero Sick. You got to wonder who's going to blink first.
Looking at Kyle's hand, he might be out of tricks. Maybe just trying to Lysander, stall for time. Maybe leave Jason in a situation where he can't Quaking Punch. Attached to Regirock again, although if you can't move those energies with a Aromatisse, the play is a little less strong.
Yeah, this is, it's not a bad play at all from Kyle. Brings up that other Seismitoad EX. If Jason can't find a Super Scoop Up or AZ to move that Seismitoad or a double colorless energy to use Quaking Punch, this could break that lock. This could give Kyle an opportunity.
He does hit heads on the Crushing Hammer, so this Seismitoad's going to lose pretty much all playability. He does have a Sycamore as well, which does give him a decent shot at finding another double or a way... Oh, first card.
Oh, man. These players are pretty much drawing the cards they want at will at this point. Jason also looks like, he got the double colorless energy. Also has a computer search if he wants to go for that Hypnotoxic Laser. All sorts of options. And got to think, with time winding down, any prize you can take is just going to put you in an even better position.
Oh, yeah. I mean, this Seismitoad is threatening Kyle's loss of two more prize cards to Jason. And then even if you maybe eventually win this game in a fully timed game, I do see that Regirock can have utility. He's got a lot of time to go. Maybe he could win this in a full game, but we're talking about limited time. You have to play against the clock, and Kyle definitely has his back to the wall.
Yeah, without Aromatisse in play, having energy on Regirock is okay. You have energy, but what are you going to do? Put four energy on it and Stone Edge?
That's kind of the play I see, you know. What else is he going to do? He has the energy for it. It's just taking a lot of time.
I mean, it takes 4 to use Stone Edge. You do 80, maybe 120. It's not the best trade in the world. You definitely need to get Aromatisse, and you need it very quickly.
And Jason's sort of seeing the benefit of him being able to play up on prizes. Does drop that Hypnotoxic Laser, and now Seismitoad is in a horrible position.
Yeah, we're in that spot again. Seismitoad's going to get knocked out going back into Jason's turn unless Kyle can have a counter stadium. The Verbank City Gym can add those 2 extra damage counters, going to reach that knockout. So, man, tough spot for Kyle. It seemed like at points he had great opportunities to kind of break Jason down, but Jason drawing the right cards at the right times.
So Kyle, able to search his deck for 2 basic Pokemon. Perhaps now we finally see a Virizion, but maybe that's just delaying the inevitable.
Yeah, looks like Virizion is the choice here. Go ahead and grab that. Finally, game 3 comes out.
Pies him 1 turn.
But I'm not sure what the plan is here. I mean, if he attaches to the Seismitoad just to prevent it from being knocked out, that's not a great situation, right? You'd just lose an energy in that spot. So he might start powering up Virizion EX. I'm not sure.
Yeah, it's rough. I mean, maybe he's... Oh, yeah, that looks like the play. Attached to prevent it from knocked out. Jason's like, oh, so close.
Yeah, so you do prevent the knockout going back into Jason's turn, but you don't prevent the Quaking Punch knockout. So, I don't know. It's a weird trade-off there. You lose your energy. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. Kyle's deck is sort of built for these really long games, and he just doesn't have the time for it.
Yeah, and I also noticed he didn't take Spritzy off that Pokemon fan clubber, saying he needs Aromatisse, but yeah. He didn't take it. So
I can only imagine he's biding his time, perhaps, for some Wally Miracles, but it might be a little too late.
Yeah, so now Crushing Hammer. I think Jason's just playing this to get rid of it. Get rid of a card in your hand so you can set up for more, maybe, or before Professor Sycamore. Yeah, he's going to set up for 4 cards this time. Just trying to improve his position, maybe find Muscle Band or some more cards. Even Absol could be pretty good here.
And wow, to think, this game went all down to first the initial top deck, then a coin flip for Jason. Could be completely different in another world.
Oh, we see the Cursed Eyes moving the damage from Regirock to the active, the 10 needed to get the knockout. Now Kyle has to promote a different Pokemon.
Devastating. Because now Jason can start applying damage to a new target. And Kyle, thinking he did everything, you know, the Virizion preventing a knockout, he still technically does get knocked out before he promotes something new.
That's right. Now, interesting to note about Regirock, it has that Omega Barrier, which means Hypnotoxic Laser cannot affect it. And that means Seismitoad EX will take 3 hits to knock it out. Even with a Muscle Band, you're doing 50. It's weak to grass, not water. So, I mean, it takes 3 Quaking Punches to take this Regirock down. And if Jason doesn't find a Muscle Band, it'll take 4.
Well, right now he's at least on the track for 4, just 30 damage. This would be a pretty interesting play if Kyle just had 1 more energy on the Regirock.
Right.
I almost wonder, was it a better play to attach to the Regirock and allow Seismitoad to fall?
Yeah, that's the trade-off that we saw last turn. Regirock does have a first attack we might see. We could see Landmaker gets 2 stadium cards back out of your discard pile. Not sure how relevant it'll be, but...
I mean, hey, it's something. Oh, yeah. See, I guess on this turn, he could maybe have started the Stone Edges.
Yeah, Landmaker. Add that to the list, Josh, of things I didn't expect to see this weekend.
I did not. Well, he's making some land, or making some sky, actually, bringing the sky fields into his hand.
Yeah, and, man, I don't know if there's much time left in the round or what's happening here, but you got to think Jason has put himself in the lead no matter what the situation is.
Oh, yeah. No, he can really run away with it. He can afford to play methodically and, seal his opponent. He can even do weird stuff that he might not have otherwise done, like Lysandra, a new target out just to buy time. He's in a perfect spot.
Yeah, at this point, he's just kind of analyzing his options, seeing what is the best way for me to be able to win this game. Regirock can get powered up for Stone Edge next turn, but at most that does 120 damage. You're not particularly worried about that. Kyle's just in such a rough spot. Doesn't even have his Darkrai EX for Dark Cloak to retreat. Doesn't have any Spritzy or Aromatisse out to Fairy Transfer, so this is just bad all around.
Yeah, I mean, Regirock can maybe two-shot Toads, but even after all that, Jason can bite even more time. He's got AZs, super scoop-ups, all the good stuff. If you can't get one-hit knockouts on Toads, it's just way too hard to beat them in the prize trade over time.
Yeah, and I just want to point out, Absol has been absolutely huge in all three of these games, getting knockouts in three straight games. This one card in Jason's deck, just manipulating math, you don't seem like moving three damage counters would be such a big deal, but three straight games, that ability has gotten him a knockout.
Oh, yeah. I mean, even though you're moving it from one target to another, especially in a deck like Seismitoad, it's not uncommon for you to sort of chip away at your opponent, and it can sort of help knock out some hiding targets. I really think it's a great card to be able to move three damage counters on one regular basic.
Right. So now it'll be on Kyle's turn. I think time may have been called at this point. I'm not particularly sure. Jason seemed like he was motioning that might be Kyle's first turn of time or something like that. But
it is helpful. He told me next time on stream, I'm going to try and give you a motion so that you guys know.
and yes, it must. Yeah. Kyle concedes the game, and Jason Kozinski overcomes this bad matchup against Kyle. Wow. It was an incredible series, just slowly breaking things down, and eventually Quaking Punch, that one attack, carries Jason Kozinski to the finals of this tournament.
Oh, man, what a draining matchup that must be. That is so much Pokemon, and it's just one round, but it was the deciding factor between being top four and being a potential champion.
Yeah, I mean, we've said time and time again, Jason is no stranger to being in the finals of tournaments. Three-time world champion. He's a multiple-time regional champion as well. No surprise to see him in the finals, but, I mean, that was certainly an uphill battle.
Oh, yeah. And you can see how close these games can go. It's down to the wire. It's down to a top deck. Game two may be saved by the top deck of the AZ.
The super scoop-up heard around the world.
And then the super scoop-up heard around the world.
So just it's incredible to watch. I always love watching Jason play, seeing his thought processes. But I do want to give tons of credit to Kyle. What an incredible showing this weekend. Brought such a creative deck to the table. And I think he's earned himself a lot of fans this weekend.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, when you're playing a deck that many players sort of don't deal with often, you can win yourself a lot of friends. And when you beat Seismitoad, you can win yourself a lot of friends. Unfortunately, you couldn't take down perhaps the greatest Toad in the room, but he came darn close. And the amount of patience he had in Game 2 is a lot more than I think other players would show.
Yeah, incredible match, and we still have one more to go. We're still finding out who the other finals opponent will be for Jason Kozinski.